Well, you wake up in the morning, you hear the work bell ring, and I march you to the table. You see the same old thing. Ain't no food upon the table. There's no fork up in the pan. But you better not complain, boy. You get in trouble with the man.
Let the midnight special shine a light on me. Let the midnight special shine a light on me. Let the midnight special shine a light on me.
This is Imperial Beach, 15 minutes south of America's finest city, San Diego, California. The average price of a home in San Diego is currently $325,000. IB is a beautiful beach community bordering Tijuana, Mexico, and the famous Coronado Island. The oceanfront properties here are beyond compare. Thousands pass through IB daily, as Palm Avenue connects to the military bases here and in Coronado. As you pass through, you can't help but notice the homeless walking the medians, panhandling in front of local stores, and some digging through trash cans hoping to find their next meal or just a few cans to cash in. Most people passing through ignore what they see. Others don't care. Some call it annoying. The homeless call it surviving.
Brandon, I've lived in IB my whole life, and it's a pretty safe place to be homeless. It's been like 2 months now that I've been trying to get in Job Corps, and they say it's supposed to be all that easy, and I can't be a resident over there at Job Corps because I got kids, and that's becoming a difficulty thing, and it's just like totally bunk the way that these people are saying, okay, we're putting out help, here, come and get it, and then you go and get it, and then you get all these difficulties.
Near where?
Over there by the Wiener Schnitzel.
And somebody attacked you?
Yeah. 4 black guys and 1 white lady. Mm-hmm.
And you had to have stitches?
I got stitches in my head.
That's horrible.
Try desperately to lock me in the trash can.
In the trash can?
Yeah. I just had to lock on the top.
That's awful.
Surprisingly, she shoots dead Minguez right out of the middle of it.
And did anybody see this happening?
Yeah.
And nobody did anything?
63 cents, thanks.
And so nobody did anything about this at all?
took me over to the clinic, which was the Imperial Beach Pet Hospital.
That's
the sheriff said, the doctor there said, "You're not gonna like this, Susie bitch." I said, "You're not gonna like it when we cut your fucking thumbs off."
That's terrible.
Yeah. Call me a Susie bitch, whatever a Susie bitch is.
So they gave you the stitches for free?
Yeah. 22 motherfucking times. Killing Vietnamese. Hey. Call me a wrong Indian.
And did they, when they stitched you up, did they give you a bill or did they do it for free?
They, sprayed something on it and then they stitched it. At the Imperial Beach Pet Clinic, of that, no, I refuse to tell them my medical insurance number.
But they still did it?
Yeah.
That's good.
Guys were arrested on the premises for sales of heroin little plastic things. I thought they were, you know, like the vitamin packs. You got the little different colored type of vitamins. It's what they look like. They didn't even look like heroin. They don't dissolve in the body. Oh. Measure body temperature, cerebral temperature. And it has a big round ring. They put it around their neck and boo, because they're black people. Oh. And for real, babe, it has fought off the Magoo that has come across the border quite a few times. Oh. And they're all hairy and they're black. And they're called the Magoo.
How long have you been homeless, Sue?
Oh, the way.
Nobody even gonna, the camera won't see me though, is the point is. It'll be a somebody else and shit.
Why?
Just because I'm too good, homes. I got magic crystal balls, the world, everything behind me. And it'll be some fucking idiot. Like when I look in the mirror, you think that's me in the mirror? That thing's taking me over and shit, man.
If you don't mind me asking, how did you end up homeless?
Because my husband was a drug dealer and a user and abuser. That's all I can say.
So you left him or did he kick you out?
I left him after he started beating on me. I should have left him when he first started beating on me, but then after a while he started beating on me again, and he was wrapped up with another friend of his.
She's a typical case of what you'd see like in the movies.
They kicked me in the ribs,
she was strangling me.
And so this was your only way out?
Yeah.
And so
I can deal with the problem by myself. I don't need a man that's gonna beat you. You know, you walk away from the situation. That's all there is to it. And I can deal with whatever. I gotta keep going to church.
So you go to church regularly?
Well, I haven't been lately, but I've been going. Yeah, I go over there.
No, she goes
to pizza.
She goes back to the sister stamps. I see her there all the time. St. James.
So that's cool. You listen to a little bit of worship. And God bless. And up and all the above. And I was having, it wasn't really a nightmare, it was more like a vision. I mean, it wasn't torture. Well, yeah, it was torture. But anyway, I can't explain it. Yeah, I didn't know it. I mean, I've had nightmares when I was a kid, but this was something very different. It was like a film going off in my head. About somebody being murdered and... Ooh. There's some freaky people out there.
So, describe what you do on an average night.
Well, when it gets time. When it gets dark, we like, if we see somebody, we'll ask them for change and stuff, and then we'll either get something to eat, something more to eat, or something more to drink and stuff, and then we go back to the park. We'll find our blankets, lay down, and go to sleep. That's about what we do. Do we see the corner right there? Where the hill is?
Yeah.
We go just down in that where that hill is. And every night, like, we'll set up our little bed, and then one of us will curl up, and the other one will go out to the walkway to see how well you can see us. And if you can see us too well, we'll go hide some more. Just because. And nobody's ever messed with us down here but the cops. We got up, got a bunch of blankets, and we came and slept in the park. And we slept right up against the Boys and Girls Club fence where the playground is. And nobody said anything. And so a couple times since we've been homeless, we'd sleep over there. And like they have the bingo and stuff, nobody ever said anything to us. The only people were the cops. But we were sleeping there one night, what freaked me out is we saw a guy shooting up one night in the park.
Here in the park?
Yeah.
Right over there?
And we're like, oh. And I guess I had coughed or something, and when he heard us, he left. Didn't mess with us.
So like when it rains, or gets really nasty out, like really windy, where do you guys go?
Down by the 76 gas station.
The only place with cover.
The only place with cover. And it's pretty cool because my uncle works there. So they're pretty cool.
Bigger than I thought.
They haven't found this spot yet. This is the only hidden spot we have. Otherwise, like, if we leave them out for like a couple minutes, we come back and they're gone. Like, I lost my knee brace behind a dumpster. Put it in a bag with some cans we were gonna recycle. Came back and they were gone. So I've been walking around without my knee brace. And hopefully my leg will feel better, you know, so I don't have to depend on it anymore. But this is the only safe spot we have to keep our stuff at. Otherwise, we have to keep worrying about where we're gonna get our blankets. Try to go buy some, but they're too expensive. I'm not gonna spend $3 on a blanket unless it's like really thick. So we can just keep warm at night with a few blankets.
Now the thrift stores up there, like the Goodwill and that other thrift store.
Well, we never make it to the Goodwill. They always close by the time we get enough money. The other ones, they have like thin, small blankets for like $3.75 and stuff, and so we pass those off. You want to bother with.
Now the Goodwill especially, one of their main points is helping out homeless families and everything. And do they ever give away anything to you guys at all, or is it just like a pay-only situation?
It's a pay-only situation. Unless they throw something away, then we can get it. Like, we found some backpacks or some, you know, every once in a while clothes or something useful. The church right here is the main place that will help us, though. That church will give us canned foods, and last Sunday of every month they give out meals. So they're real nice. I like that too. Kind of a long walk to be walking all the time. I hate walking back and forth. They have to do this in the morning too.
And so nobody ever finds your stuff here?
Oh no, we got all our clothes and stuff in there. The only problem is people that know what's in there, sometimes they'll go and steal our clothes. We had 4 bags, but now we're down to 2. So.
And this is other homeless people?
Yeah, we figure. Because they're the only people that know what's in there. No one ever sees us going in and out. We watch out, make sure no one sees us.
If it stays like that, our head and our legs are in the turn.
Then turn it the long way. Is the other one still down there?
Where?
There was one over here earlier.
No, it's not. Turn it long way?
Yeah.
It looks like we can cover up with this thing. I usually sleep with your head anyways, I put it in here. It's an ordeal to get ready for bed at night.
Yeah.
You have to set up and everything. Blankets at the moment. And this is where we sleep.
Yeah, usually we climb under the blankets and pull these over so it gets dark enough.
Yeah,
so
we don't
go to sleep.
We usually don't let the white blanket show because that's what attracts attention over here is the white, you know, at night.
Yeah.
So we have the darker ones on top. And every day we lose our cardboard. Because there's nowhere to hide it here.
This is one of the blankets the church gave us, this brown one.
And then the Soul Seekers for Christ thrift store right there, you know?
They gave us
this white comforter.
We don't tell the other people because they don't want everybody running in there and free stuff.
Asking for freebies and stuff.
I just couldn't make it to ask the lady before she donated it, so she said, you know what, you can have it. And I said, okay, thank you. She said, just don't tell nobody. And I was like, all right. Make sure not to tell everybody.
Our blankets right now are kind of like our babies. We're afraid to lose them. We found that it seems like it's the safest spot because it's harder to see us from out there.
You're kind of down that little slope, and so when we lay down, no one can see us.
Yeah, the only problem is we wake up several times in the middle of the night because we slide down the hill. We'll wake up with our feet hanging out and stuff. And there's a little dog that lives in the yard right there.
Yeah.
You wake up to him barking in the morning.
Hardly ever out at night.
So it's almost like your alarm clock.
Yep. Yeah. That, the birds, and the people walking up to the food line.
They usually talk and stuff, so if we can hear the faint voices of them, we'll just like wake up and be like, oh, it's gonna be 8 o'clock at least.
I used to cry like every single night. When we first came out here, I was crying all the time and dreading the nighttime and dreading the morning when we wake up. It was horrible.
Yeah.
But,
Bye. See you guys later.
Bye.
This store about almost 11 years here, but we don't give out food to the homeless and need it here. We do give clothing to when there's someone in need. But we give it out. I live at 986 9th Street and out in my backyard. We give food 6 days a week.
So you almost run a sort of a soup kitchen, like in your backyard?
We call it a pantry. Where we give food, fruits, vegetables, and bread, and all kinds of goodies.
I learned about you from Felix, and he's a really sweet guy. He gave me a great interview. And about how long would you say that he's been working with you? You said he does take donations for you.
Yeah, he does. He brings in stuff all the time for him. But he's been around, how many years? We've been about at least 12 to 15.
On an average day, about how many homeless and needy families would you say turn up at your residence for the pantry?
Oh, I would say we have at least 25 or 30.
And you see the same faces quite often?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Now, I know there's a few mentally ill homeless people that may need medication or help, and Felix also mentioned that you guys help to get the medication.
We do everything we can for them, yes.
That's really good. And how many would you say, in an estimate, would you say that need medical help or some kind of regular medicine?
Most of the homeless really need. Most of them, they have need for it. I would say at least 10 to 12 of them anyway, that comes around daily. We have people who come.
Okay. One of my main goals is to ask the city what they can do about a shelter.
Yes.
And just tell me what your views on a shelter here in Imperial Beach would be.
Well, that's something that I've wanted for 30 years, and I haven't been able to get one myself. So.
Have you spoke to the city about it yourself?
No, because when I went to talk to them about, you know, the homeless people, they didn't want to hear.
So. I'll be the first one to give $1,000 to all the shelters.
Hallelujah.
Yes. the city will develop it.
Yes, they will develop it. Oh, good.
Well, that was my next question,
yeah.
Because everybody knows a shelter does cost money.
Yes.
And it's going to take a few bucks out of each of our tax dollars.
Yeah.
I personally would be willing to pay, and hearing that you'd be willing
to... It'll be a big help to everybody because of tremendous problem they create in the city.
Yes.
It is such a small city.
Uh-huh.
So,
but with conditions that we keep them off the streets here and the alleys, and that the city helps us with that. They haven't really cooperated the fullest.
Well, see, that's right. But if you had a shelter, then the people have somewhere to go.
Exactly.
If you had a shelter for them, then you can have means where they could study, where they could get training. That's what
this.
Too. Oh yes, they're gonna have that because that's they have the truth. But yet and still, they need a place where they can go, and to know that someone cares, and you know, a place where they can eat.
So if you
they can
the
have a clean
rolling,
place.
It'd be great.
And to share with people, show them. That we care enough that they have shelter, because there's no shelter here.
And do you think that in general people have a misunderstanding about the homeless problem?
Yes.
What would you say would probably be the first misconception everyone has?
What I have heard, I've heard them say, oh, that's where they want to be. But I know better. Nobody wants to be in that condition. anybody, everybody needs some help, but they need someone to show them the way. Because some is hurt, really hurting, and they are out there. And some people say, oh, well, they just want to be. And I said, not so. Nobody wants to be out in the cold. No one wants to be where they have, no one cares. Everybody wants someone to care for them. This is where we've been, helped to generate funds to feed the people and to help the people.
So you use the money that you get here to help
all
them?
All the volunteers here. Mm-hmm. No one gets paid. All the pays goes for paying our rent, paying, you know, the bills. And the other part goes to help the homeless and needy families.
Mm-hmm. And now, do you get a lot of donations, or is it a situation where it's a little dry?
Yeah, we get lots of not for food. Lots of donations for clothing and stuff like that. You get plenty of that. But for the food and stuff, no. Our donations come through, just like I said.
Okay, and... Now, Felix had told me about a church that is run in conjunction with this place here, and...
Well, we are a ministry within ourselves. We're Soul Seekers for Christ Evangelistic Missions, but I do go to church, the First Assembly of God Church right up there. But they do not support us. But I've been there since 30 years, so, you know.
So you're yeah. pretty much doing this on your own?
Because that's what God gave me to do. Mm-hmm. But I don't ever give up. I just keep believing that one day there will be a shelter.
These guys out there in a wheelchair and shit like this, bumming for money, will work for money. How's he going to work in a wheelchair? You work putting a wheelchair up when it's all over and he goes home. He puts your wheelchair away and walks away. I can understand people. But you know what? You can't punish everybody for that shit. You can't punish the people that ain't doing that for that shit. Well, they do, but it ain't right.
So, what's the best thing you think a shelter would do for this city?
Shelter would do for this city? Put a lot more people in jail because the cops would hang all over that sucker until they find something. If they can't find something, they'll make something up to. But they'll find some way of tearing it down. I don't think you're going to get a shelter for this city. Well, unless you agree to keep animals and birds and stuff in it, not no human beings. You know?
So you think the city's more interested with their wildlife protection than protection of their own citizens?
This city, just like any other city, is worrying about not seeing these homeless people on the street and to line their pockets. And I'm not asking for no shelter or nothing like that, but I do not expect to be under a goddamn tree and sit to have a cop or anybody else say, hey, man, you can't stay here. You got to move so the animals can live there. You know? You're going to get arrested next time we find you. What the fuck?
Straight up.
Yeah. I ain't necessarily asking for shelter. I'm just saying, leave me alone. Fuck. I can understand people shitting. Cops stopped me once, standing over here in the back of the church. He said, I realized a female blonde-haired cop stopped me one time, county. She pulled up there and said, what are you doing here? She said, I realized IB is the armpit. Yeah, I didn't say that. This is the first words that were said. I realized IB was the armpit of this, you know, area and shit like that. But it's people like you, and that pissed me off right there. But I let her go on to make it like that. And I said, okay, first of all, I said, what do you mean people like me? Well, you know, where do you shower? I said, where the fuck do you shower? I mean, where do you shower? Where do you take a piss? I said, I don't piss
hotels
in the
hotels every once in a while.
Huh?
Hotels every once in a while.
Yeah, well, I got to admit that I've seen people shit in places that they shouldn't be shitting and stuff like that. But, you know, what the fuck? Dog shit all up and down. I got to rather have dog shit than, well, human shit is a little bit. I don't know. Okay, you got. But there's restrooms here. I use the restrooms here. A lot of times, Taco Bell, I go in that restroom. I'm in there for 10 seconds, man. Bang, 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 bang. It's like they sit there and why can't they just knock on the door? But that's not what they're knocking on the door for. They're knocking on the door because I'm not buying any fucking thing, you know? Well, okay, then from now on, I'll shit out on the sidewalk in front of your fucking business, you know? What the fuck? And Cannon is illegal. You know, you can't, here in IB, you can to get no money. And if you don't have, they say get a job. Well, until you get a job, you ain't got no fucking money to wash your clothes or nothing like this. You can't, you know. But I have been detained on the street for more than 2 hours at one fucking time, just doing tests and shit, you know, and stripping and having to pulling my boots and shit off. That's a bunch of crap, man. They're treating me like a fucking.
With that dude.
They don't even treat prisoners of war that bad. Just because I'm homeless don't mean it.
I'm leaving.
Now he's probably wondering why everybody's in a group for it. Can't nobody stand in a group and talk?
Standing here and talking.
Yeah, that's the truth.
No. How does it go? You do not fight with the system.
Okay, now, Sam, the reason I'm saying this, now, I can understand why he pulled through. He's just checking us out. Maybe he hadn't, nobody had time enough to call. But 7-Eleven's
open. There's there, too.
There's no trouble in there. Or they would get on the phone and call, right? All these places are open. If something was happening, somebody would be called on and all the law, right?
He does not have even the right.
Oh, yes, he does. He's a
citizen. Probably a fucking child molester now.
Probably, but you just condemned him. I could say that about you, and I'd be wrong. Because I don't know that.
Well, I was hearing about that shit on the radio a little while ago. They stole somebody's little girl or something.
Yeah, there's a little girl missing right now in the area.
Yeah, 7-year-old. I think her father or the neighbor did. But I think, if there's a need for homeless shelter, there's a need for it, I guess. And there's no reason why they shouldn't donate money for something like that. They donate money for the goddamn birds to sleep in the bush. They donate, they got a whole goddamn, almost the whole coast. Any place where there's not a home, it's set aside for wildlife or some shit, you know? The whole river bottom, you know? All the way up and down here is bird estuary. Well, they ain't going no place either. The existing shelters that they got, they say they got a whole list of them. I tell you what, that one of them son of bitches go up there and try to get in one undercover or some shit. They're all full, or you got to pay to get in. Now, what the fuck is a homeless dude got a bunch of money for that they can pay to get in a fucking homeless shelter? That don't make no goddamn sense to me, man. or they're full. They're always full. Now, the only thing, I've heard one place that will take you up on.
Are you getting shit stolen from you?
Well, that you get shit stolen from you, no matter what.
I was having my skateboard stolen from me, straight up.
What they're probably figuring is we put up a shelter, that's going to cost us. But they give game shows and shit where they give all the shit away and tax write-off. Why don't they tax write-off of it? You know? Hey, all the more power to you, but I don't think you get it. And if you do, the law's going to be wanting to have something. Yeah, I don't know. I can sit here and explain it all night. The law will get away with what the fuck they're getting away with, and it's wrong. They'll get away with choking that guy to death. I don't give a shit what he was swallowing. I don't give a shit what he was swallowing. That's no reason to help him fucking die. You know, jump all over him and choke him.
Or else Marty. No, I knew Marty.
Yeah, well, I didn't know him, but that's bullshit, man. Choking because he's swallowing drugs. Let him swallow the drugs. Let him go to jail to hide, but don't choke the motherfucker to death.
The estuary is home to many different kind of birds. Many, many different kinds. Up and down the estuary you can find different types of duck, geese, seagulls, pelicans. It's just a very small area, almost like a creek. But fish and birds live here. This is where they call their home. You can see the pelican there. Well, it looks like people do come down here. Old railroad tracks. Well, there's footprints in the mud on the other side here. And judging by what I'm seeing here, somebody had to have been down here today, maybe to take a bath. I don't know if it's going to show up on the video how charred it is.
but it's very evident that there has been fires set right in this spot, which is actually very dangerous. Some of the foliage is charred as well up around this tree. This is by no means a good thing. With a car or what?
Yeah, with the truck. Right.
While you were skating?
Cut his ass naked in the middle of Palm.
Oh, they cut my clothes all the way up to here and shit.
What? Did you have to go to the hospital?
Yeah, dude, I saw my bone, dude.
Oh my god. That's awful.
He's got mad ass scars. And then they said it was his fault because he was riding on the wrong side of the street. But we always stop and look at that fucking driveway before we cross it first.
Well, it's crazy here on this street, especially on the streets. As I was walking down Palm Avenue.
Yeah.
Oh, I hope we got enough money for this. So we still got $1.40 something. I bet about $1.40. You want to get something else? Want some soda or anything?
Yeah, thirsty. Yeah.
Okay, thanks
for that. Soda.
Sounds good to me. I know I can't live without it.
So keep that banana on. Brian.
Lemon nug.
So we still got like 69 more cents. Want something else?
That's it.
Sure. We'll save
violators will be prosecutor. Yeah, so.
No, they so get they, homeless people like they're some kind of dogs or something.
And they don't even know why we're homeless. I mean, it's not like I did anything wrong. Like I reached 18 and my parents stopped getting money from the government from me.
Like that. They
so they
not have
said I had to leave.
But you don't treat them like they're some kind of, you know, animal or something. You know, that's how they treat them, though, you know, like they're.
And there's nowhere
you
can sleep.
They shouldn't do that. Should be, just because they don't have very much doesn't make no difference, you know, what you've got or what you have. You know, it makes no difference.
It shouldn't make any difference.
Well, I have a question, because you just said there ain't nowhere to sleep. So, like, during that ice storm the other day, I know you guys remember it, because it doesn't happen here often. Like,
yep,
where did you guys go to sleep?
The park.
The park.
And the cops came and told us we had to leave.
During the storm?
Yep. Our blankets
and you didn't have any shelter
everywhere, or? And we had to leave. And so we just stayed, we walked
yeah,
around IB all night.
Leave.
You want
to
see the blisters on my feet from walking around all night?
They don't like you sleeping at the park.
They
you
don't. There's
don't
nowhere
like
you
that.
Can sleep. There's
no.
Nowhere. The cops come
they
and they
like
take
it.
You to jail straight
to
Las Colinas or.
You can sleep up at the bank, you know, where the bank is.
Can't
I slept
sleep.
There a couple of times myself.
Can't sleep there anymore.
Can't sleep there anymore. They tell you to leave. They don't want you there.
Man, let's get down to the damn point. Give me 35 cents first. Second of all, and shit, they only profile enough to fuck me homeless. They have nothing better to do than shit. By the time they motherfucking get in touch with the people that's in here in IB, the people who love IB, the people who've known IB for their whole entire life, they're too busy wasting their time. Oh, hey, buddy, we'll make this homeless person move off that corner, this corner, that corner, this corner. When, in fact, they don't give a damn about what's really going on in IB because for the simple reason They ain't give a fuck about Marty and shit.
Yeah.
Hell, they killed Marty.
Yeah.
And swore him down. That poor man motherfucking swallowed a whole bag of them. Marty ain't swallowed shit. They beat the crap out of him right down there before they get to the beach. And they didn't care. Now, you know what? Marty wasn't that kind of person.
And because they're the cops, they can cover it up.
So you guys knew Marty personally?
Yeah.
Tell me a little bit about what he was like.
I didn't know him too much, but from, like, I've met him once or twice, but I guess he was really close friends with my mom, from what I've heard. So
he just wasn't the type to do what they said he did?
No.
Actually, they pulled Marty over because Marty was going down the wrong side of the street on a bicycle. Marty, in turn, turned the corner. They came up on Marty and started messing with Marty down by the 7-Eleven. Not this first one, but the second one. And when Marty got off the bike, that's when they started beating the crap out of him.
Just automatically?
Ooh, it was pretty much automatic. I'll put it this way. One man and a bunch of cops. You know yourself.
Come on.
But Marty stood there, and they came up on him, and they beat him down, and they killed him. So they got no love from me.
And do they harass you on a daily basis, do you say?
In 3 days, we got stopped by 8 cops. No, 2 days, 8 cops.
They do it every day.
8 cops.
We can't go over to Jack in the Box to eat. We can't go to Burger King. We can't go to McDonald's. No. We can't even sit right here because that bald head bitch right there.
Yeah.
Let me tell the truth the way it is.
Yep.
Mrs. Save-A-Lot.
Mrs.
Frigger.
They call the cops every time they see us out here. And we're not, all we're doing is sitting here and conversing among ourselves. We aren't harming anybody. Just about everybody that walks past here knows us and says hi and stops and talks to us. I don't even know how to describe it.
You know what homeless is? You want to know, don't you? Do you know? Do you have a place to go every night?
Yes.
You do?
Yes.
You got some place to lay down and go to sleep?
Warm shower.
Where you'll be, you know, not worrying about what's going to walk up on you, what's going to happen, because you never know what anybody or anything will do.
Scared to death every night?
No, I'm never scared.
I'm always scared.
I take God with me.
I take God with me, and
God will always be with you.
Sizzler probably and stand there until somebody buys me a steak dinner. I don't do that though. I just eat fast foods. I don't care about food. I need money. I got food. Somebody just bought me a hamburger and fries. I threw the soda away because I got a hole in my tooth. I can't eat soda.
If you were offered dental help, would you take it if it was for free? Would you let someone fix your mouth?
To have dude jerk my tooth out with some pliers.
Your friend?
That's what you want? The dentist.
Okay.
I'm gonna die, bro. I cannot chew on this side. The dentist down there, they said I need a Medi-Cal card. Well, I'm gonna go, guys.
They recently took our blankets. Was it yesterday?
It pouring rain. We went to go late to get out of the rain because we had a place where it was covered and stuff. We wanted to get warm because we were soaked. And we went there and everything was gone.
Our
our food, our bag of clothes with our, some things we had, like gold bond, Vaseline for our chapped lips, and
clothes, our shampoo and conditioner, everything. Tomorrow morning at 8 o'clock, we're planning on going to the police station and tell them we lost some blankets, because they know that's the last one found right there. And we're gonna see if they'll give us our blankets back.
At least the ones that we left before we were homeless.
Because we have about, if they give us any of them back, we have about 20 of them all together. And I have some thick down comforters and stuff. So, but they took all of it, and they just are constantly harassing us no matter where we go.
Why do you think they would take your blankets?
Because they don't want us to come back, and they probably figure that if we don't have blankets, then we can't go, you know, we can't go sleep somewhere.
They tell us to go to find a friend's house we can go stay at.
Or move to a different city.
Yeah, we tell them we have no friends we can stay with. And no one around here. They tell us to just leave anyways.
Go to a different city or something.
Well, tell me exactly what happened last night, being that you didn't have your blankets. I mean, explain to me.
We were in a little shed that felt like it was going to fall apart at any minute. Had holes all over the roof, spiders crawling everywhere, and we had one thin blanket. It was paper thin, and it wasn't even big enough to cover the two of us.
And we had to lay on it and fold it over as like a taco shell.
And we were laying on, it was just...
We had to use a piece of board for a door, and there's still
and there were holes in the bottom of the shed, so we were trying whatever we could to patch the holes up so we didn't fall through.
Board laying over the animal...
crap.
Yeah.
It was horrible.
So did the rain still get through even though...
Not really. No. It was freezing as hell, but we didn't get wet.
It was freezing.
I woke up every hour, and it was still dark, and we had no watch. We were just waiting for the first sign of light to come through. So we knew it was morning and safe to be out on the street, walk around somewhere, do something.
But before that, as soon as we got in and laid down, the cops had came over and told us to leave.
As soon as we got there, we weren't even in there 5 minutes. We didn't make any noise or anything, and the cops were there. And the exact same cops were the ones that arrested Chiefy 10 minutes later.
Yeah.
We walked down to the Savvy Foods, and we saw them harassing Chiefy.
Did they threaten you? I mean...
Well... They told us to leave because it was trespassing, even though we had permission to stay there. And the owner of the land gave our friend permission to stay there. But the neighbor
gave our friend permission to let us stay there. But a neighbor's the one that called because he thinks that anybody who stays there is going to be a dope dealer and everything.
Or he doesn't want no transients around his house.
So that's what he said. That's why he called the cops.
But you said they came up on you with a gun drawn.
Yeah. Three different police officers all had guns.
Pointing. But they knew that you were homeless and that you couldn't possibly have...
Yeah.
Well, obviously, yeah.
And when they asked us if we have anything else they could see in there, all we had was my shoes,
a blanket,
and a bra. Yeah. I had another bra laying on the floor in my shoe. I had an extra one. And they saw that, and they still just kept the guns pointing at us. And the thing is, I feel... It's not embarrassed, but I don't know how to explain it, because every single time the cops say something to us, they ask us where we live and everything, and we tell them, and it's almost like they're making fun of it, you know? Yeah.
It's they know, but they just want to...
And they keep asking the questions, you know, don't you have any friends that you can stay at? And I always tell them, I have lots of friends, but none of them live around here, or they've all gone away at college and crap. And it's just it's almost like they're intentionally poking fun at us.
Well, they even assume, because when we got pulled over by undercovers a while back, they basically were harassing me about, where do I live? Why don't I have a house? And what I'm trying to do to get into a house.
Why aren't you taking care of me and stuff? And they don't understand that he was until we got kicked out of where we were staying.
Or when they caught us at the park, they said, where are you going to take her to live? Under a tree?
You know?
And seriously, I didn't find that funny at all.
It was rude.
They basically think we chose to be out here and we don't want to get off the streets. They think we want to stay out here.
And they act like we're a bunch of hoodlums, but when we're two 19-year-olds and we seem to be able to feed 8 other homeless people in IB, and we're the only, you know what I'm saying?
Take care of people that are older than us.
We spend our money, we know we're not going to be able to get a hotel room and it's just going to be able to feed us. If we know we've something that we can buy a bunch of and feed a bunch of other people, you know, we'll buy, we buy a whole 16-pack of chicken legs today. Armando and I came down here and barbecued, and we told everybody barbecue at the park. You know? And...
Marsha's supposed to be coming back, so that's why we have these 3 pieces of chicken.
And we saved chicken for the ones who didn't come. And I don't think we're doing anything wrong out here. If anything, we're helping a lot of people out, because a lot of these people wouldn't eat.
Tell me, like, a little bit about your situation, like, how you ended up here, man.
Yeah, basically, got my car stolen. I was in Imperial Valley, Imperial City. I was at the beach. Next thing I know, I came out the water, had my wallet and everything in the car. This was, like, about 3 days ago. Boom, all of a sudden, just straight disappeared, man. My car was gone. I called 911. They said, we can't help you out. So it got all fucked up from there. So I've been out here for like 4 days now. Been all fucked up.
All right, and tell me again for the record how old you are.
I'm 24 now. I've had troubles for the last 8 months on this shit. My life has been hell, you know. Just all fucked up. So it's like, you know, basically trying to figure out how to get out of this thing, man. It doesn't look pretty from my angle. Yeah. That's me, man. My name's Dwayne Bolden. Trying to do what I gotta do, I guess, to keep on going for one more day.
Yeah,
you got new blankets now.
Thanks to you, Jason.
Yeah.
Anytime, guys. Anytime.
It's all our old blankets got to you.
The damn cops.
Yeah. We get to enjoy the stars again. You don't have to sleep in that shed tonight.
I know. Kind of missed it last night. I was saying that last night too. I missed being able to see our stars.
Yeah, we love this spot. It's just like our spot now.
Go over a little bit about Dwayne. You were telling me some things.
Oh, yeah. Dwayne, I don't know. After that night, he didn't really stay with us. He had been staying down where the 99 cent store has their storage. Bought himself a blanket from Kmart and big old duffel bag and stuff. And it has more cash than I thought he would have. Went to him with the bank and they were saying they might not give him his cash, and then he comes back and he's got all kinds of money, buys a couple packs of cigarettes and she buys all kinds of shit. He was able to get a hotel room along with the tax that they had, so it was like 60 something. He decided to pay for the $10 phone hookup, and so he gave him 80 bucks and still had a lot more cash than that left over. It's just really surprising. We're trying to figure out where he comes up with all his money.
What happened with Marsha earlier? And the,
I guess Marsha has a little friend she goes with so she can get some money.
And so,
You think she goes with this guy to have sex?
Probably, you know. But we can never understand the woman anyway. All I know is that guy tried to pick up on Anne, and I really have, like, bitter thoughts about that guy and hate when he's around.
Does he have Marcia take a shower? Like, does she come back clean, or does she just come back with...
Well, sometimes he gets her, like, hotel rooms and stuff. He always buys her a bottle of alcohol, gives her money, you know. I think she might be doing the wrong thing going with him, but...
Now, I've heard rumors of other homeless women in this area doing that, too. Like, going with guys for money. Have you heard about any other people doing it?
There might be a couple other people, but I'm not too sure. Me and Anne just try to keep to ourselves and really just want to get back to where it's just me and her again.
I understand.
Because I guess Dwayne went off by himself. He's doing his own thing. And Marcia, we can't lay next to Marcia. She gets too weird when she gets drunk.
So. She keeps talking about bad nightmares.
Well, yeah, that too, you know, like, I don't know what it was, but it was like a movie, but it was in my brain, and it's like I was watching it through my eyes, and...
Does she say that a lot? Because she told me that the first time I talked to her.
She has been saying that a lot lately. She goes into, like, graphic details of, you know, what's actually going on in this movie, and it's just like, oh my God, you know, I don't know how the hell you can even think that. You must have watched a freaky-ass movie, but... I don't know. She just doesn't seem like she can come up with these images. He's been in the house ever since you've known him, and he's just playing off that he's nice, but it's just not the case. There's nothing nice about that guy. He's just a complete ass all around. It's kind of like how he treated Marcia when she was out here. You know, Marcia, give me your money. Marcia, go do this. Marcia, go buy that.
So he was doing that to her, too?
Yeah. He tried to do it to Anne, but Anne won't stand up and won't do that shit. Well, I can't even tell her to go do this. I just say, can you please do this? And then she'll get up and do it if she wants.
Do you think maybe he takes advantage of her still? Of
Marcia?
Marcia?
Yeah, he does. He hasn't stopped. It's like he's got Anthony and Marcia, you know, so he's got like a 2-for-1 deal going. I don't know if Joel wants it said, but he's never said it to me. But he told us that Earl was doing that to Joel. He was taking Joel's whole paycheck that he was getting, you know, and they were best friends a while back. But Joel admitted every once in a while that Earl is an ass, you know.
Did you have any other run-ins with the cops lately?
Not really. They've been leaving us alone. Maybe we can still sit here, even though we're not supposed to. We're not supposed to be sitting here, but they've been letting us lately. Which is kind of odd, really. Don't know why. Usually we move over there and they'll leave us alone because we jumped up and moved. But now they just kind of drive by and wave and, you know, ask us how we're doing and stuff. And
so would you say that this attitude has started basically since I've started filming, you think, or?
Well, yeah, we haven't been harassed so much.
Lately. So just all of a sudden?
Yeah. It's like, all of a sudden they stop. They just like over a day, they stop fucking with us and they just keep driving. You know? It's kind of odd.
think that's the area. We have to go looking around in here. So I think this is the trees that Brandon was talking about. I just hope our presence back here doesn't upset anyone.
And it's just like the tent, we got that, that's the major, I mean, we've got like the play area over here, we've got like
the, got the nursery,
yeah,
got the,
exactly, you know, I mean, I never thought it was going to be this big, so that's
shoot,
cool.
I wouldn't mind.
Mm-hmm. But see, Brandon talked us into getting that machete, and it was like, I'm going, Brandon, you're only going to use that machete just for like, okay, yeah, chop down a couple things, and then you'll be all good. Just be throwing it at things and threatening people with it and shit like that, right? And since we've been out here, he's actually used it so much. I mean, and for like chopping wood for the fire and when we were clearing out the spots, I mean, look. You know, they all had to do their little crazy thing with it or something, you know? But other than that, I mean, it's like really pretty amazing. And we've got little accommodations. Huh. I mean, you know, it was like, he kept going and wipe them down, and they're half-assed clean again. But tomorrow, we're going to go to my mom's house and take a bath. I'm going to get the kids in a bath. I'm going to take a shower. Brandon isn't too partial with my parents, so he's kind of like, oh, I don't know if I'm going to be taking a shower. I might just go and skate somewhere or something. We're going to have to make it at least for a month, you know? We've already been looking in the penny savers and shit. We found a big like a camper, mm-hmm. like a whole camper trailer thing for $700. So, I mean, we're gonna keep our eyes out and shit, and we're not gonna be doing this next month. We just can't, just because the kids, you know? I mean, me and Brandon, if it was me and Brandon, it'd be no fucking problem, you know?
I'd be down.
Yeah, I mean, there wouldn't be a problem, because me and Brandon, we could just fucking have no problem. But mm-hmm. with the kids, it's like so
there's a lot of risk in it also.
Oh, yeah, because if there was any reason that the cops should come back here, which they'd have a hard-ass fucking time finding us now. But, I mean, it's like the kids would be taken away. The whole reason that we're even down here in IB is because we moved from Oceanside to come down here to go to Job Corps to straighten our lives out for our kids, mm-hmm. you know? And the whole thing was that we were supposed to be able to stay with my parents. We were supposed to get into a place. And because we're both young parents, everybody looks at us like, oh, yeah, they're hellraisers. Oh, yeah, they're just going to do nothing but thrash the fucking place. And, oh, look, they're two young kids with two babies. And everybody's going, oh, hell no, we're not going to rent to them. And, I mean, even though we've got the money to cover it, we've got all the good meaning in the world to be down here. I mean, we've even told people we're going to Job Corps to try to make a better life for us and our kids. We just need an opportunity to get into a place. Oh, okay, well, we'll give you a call. Never hear nothing from them. We've been stressed kind of too much.
You know, and it always falls
like...
Taking
out on each other.
No. That's a bad thing. You fight with each other because things are going wrong. You know, my son's the one that wanted to call the cops.
You know, thank you.
Because I wouldn't buy some cookies.
On my birthday. So,
at the 99-cent store, because we wanted to get some meat. So we could have a decent meal.
Anyway, right?
And they called the cops. He called the cops himself. He's about to be 13. He turns 13 on the 15th. And I turned 33 on the 13th, which is just a few days away, you know? And we've been living it. We got here November 29th. Our van got stolen that night from Super 8 right there on Palm Avenue. With everything we owned, you know, my purse, my IDs, birth certificates, everything we had, that everything got stolen that night from a guy that we brought up here from Redding, California. We've come across almost everything we have. This tent was given to us by Brandon. This is filled with everything we own. And
we are
all everything else we own is behind the tent in bags. And
I can guarantee you.
Here's your pillows and your other pillows. And you know, it's like these shoes. We found those.
You borrow that light.
You know, it's like. Oh, okay, go ahead. Okay, no, it's right here.
Brad Noel.
The one thing that really irritates me the most is. Here in IB, there is nothing. There's nothing. I have a sign that says, Mom and two kids, homeless, hungry, anything helps, God bless, thank you, looking for work. And I stand on the corners, I stand on the corner of Palm and 13. The cops come by, tell me, get off the median, you have to be on the sidewalk. Most time I can stand there, and I can make enough money to feed me, my husband, my two kids, and my cat. And we've been doing okay. But then JD wanted to call the cops because of all. He didn't get what he wanted. We bought him a brand spanking new skateboard. That was his birthday present so far, and we're trying to get something else. And he wasn't happy with that either. But that's what he wanted. That's what he asked for, so that's what we got. And I spent $25 of my hard-earned money that I made out there for a skateboard for him. And it has been pure hell. It really has.
I know.
You can talk.
What do you want me to say? Hello. My name's Jay, and I'm homeless. How are you? I'm just a redneck from Colorado, come down to San Diego, got stranded down here. Guess what I found out? There ain't no help in IB.
That's about it.
Uh-huh. There we go.
See, and we've even got our pillows. Awesome, nice pillows. And my brand new sleeping bag. Oh, yeah. The thing's so warm. Me and Brad, were so warm last night, but it was like he kept trying to get out. He's going to let me the hell out of this. My new champagne. Our main thing around here, our biggest problem is water.
Lack of it?
Huh?
Lack of it?
Yeah. That's our main thing around here. I mean, it's like, we did have a problem with the heat situation, the cooking thing. And then Jay and Shelly went and they found a Coleman stove dumped in a dumpster right behind Caro's. And so, we were like, wow, really? And it had a hookup for the propane and everything. We got it all hooked up, and we've been getting him warm water for his bottles, and which is my main thing, because he'll get sick as a dog if he doesn't have warm water. We can deal with it for right now, huh, boy? Because we're tough, huh? He's got his pants, which these ones are light colored, and you know how that goes. First, me and Brandon didn't know how to get here at first, and Jay had come up there and met us, and that's how we found out how to get here. And it was like, as I'm coming back with me and the kids, I'm going, you know, nobody's gonna find us back here, just because it is so much of a mission to even get out here, going through, under, over rocks, and you know, it's just. It's a really good hidden spot, so, you know, that's one thing that we do got on our side is the security of knowing that not many people are going to be able to find us.
I have a question for you. Being that the two boys were murdered here a few years back and they just recently caught the guy back here, do you ever worry that maybe there's other vagrants that are, like, maybe out of their mind that maybe would pass through? I mean, because it is a scary place
here. I mean, for, you know, the first thing that I thought of when I first stayed here a night or two with Brandon, not in this spot, but the other spot, it was like, the first thing that came to mind was Blair Witch, you know? I was like, okay, Brandon, if I start freaking out and saying that the Blair Witch is out there, okay, just slap me a couple of times and bring me back into reality, right? And he's going, okay, don't trip out or nothing. You hear things, but it's usually rabbits or whatever. But one thing is, like, for one, we've got that big, huge machete. For two, I've always got Brandon right there. And I know Brandon and Charlie and Jay, when it comes to our lives, like even just us, me and the kids, you know, or if Shelly, when she was staying here, which she's going to be staying over there now, I know that they would protect us with their lives. You know, I mean, they would all fight to the death if anybody was coming after us. And the only thing I worry about is when I'm here by myself. Like yesterday, Brandon left me and the kids here while he went to the store. And he was like, baby, are you sure you're going to be okay? The machete is right here. If you hear anybody, tell them to call out their names or whatever. So that he said if they don't answer, if you see anybody even peering through the cracks in the window or something, he says, take the machete and go right through the fucking tent. He says, I don't give a fuck who it is. Whatever, if they ain't answering ya, then just fucking stab them, you know? He's all, because I ain't gonna take no chances of somebody coming and getting you and the kids. And I mean, he almost did not go because he was so afraid of me being by myself. But, me, I don't know, I don't really like to be here by myself because it does kind of creep me out. And Brandon has said that he's felt the spirits of those two kids out here when he was walking by himself.
Well, do you know exactly what happened? Because I can't seem to find, much about it since it did happen a couple years ago.
From what I understand, they were back here, and I guess I've been told, the old guy that was living back here, he had kidnapped them too. I mean, I guess they were already back here playing and shit, or riding their bikes or something, and he had
two for you, Brandon.
Oh, thank you. But they had either followed him, he said, hey, come over here and check out this place with me or something. But he ended up murdering him and raping him. And I'm not sure. There's been rumors about him cutting off their parts and shit like that, but I'm not sure if all that's true. But Brandon has definitely said that he even, like, started getting emotional about it. That he felt those two boys, and that they were pushing him through a bad spot. He just said, for some reason, I was going the wrong way, and I was pushed. He said, you know, I've never really been too spiritual or anything else like that. He says, but, you know, immediately I started getting the chills. I started crying for no reason. And he said that he could feel them pushing. He said he felt one on this side and one on this side. One was stronger than the other. But I think one of them was supposed to be 12, one was 14. And he said that he felt them pushing it. And when he was telling me about it, he almost started crying. had goosebumps, everything. So, you know, I know it does. I know that they are back here somewhere, and that kind of creeps me out.
Well, now, do you know everybody who stays back here, or are there other camps?
Yeah, there's other camps. Well, there's, we've got almost like a little community. We've got Shelly and Jay, Charlie. There's another couple. I forget their names at this point in time, but and they have a dog, which is like almost a, like an alarm system sometimes. But they live like over in that direction somewhere. But there was another camper that moved up to our old spot, and is sitting right there at the top of the hill. That we don't know who he is, but as far as we know, we're the, that's about it on who else is back here. We haven't really noticed anybody else. There, somebody was walking around in all white today, through the pass over here or something, and Shelly was sitting right there at the door entrance, and she goes, "Guys, I just saw some guy walk by in all white," and all three of the guys jumped up and ran out there to see who the hell it was, because we're just not used to having anybody else back here.
So you're just very careful about this place.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. We very rarely let anybody know where we're at. Just because there's no telling when anything can jeopardize the kids, you know? If there is anybody weird or strange like today, they all ran out there to make sure and see who it was and pretty much say, "Hey, dude, what the fuck are you doing here?" You know? Just because that's something that... We don't need people running through here that might say something to somebody, you know? Might hear the kids playing or something and say, "Hey, somebody's living back there with their fucking kids," you know? We don't want to take any chances. Come on, you guys want to come in? Come on, baby, I gotta get back in there with the boy.
Yeah, that baby needs a bottle. Where's the water, Dad?
Both backpacks. You got 4 gallons of fucking water. Well, Monday, got arrested for shoplifting. Tried to explain to them I was homeless and I was hungry, and some reason I did it. But it didn't really matter to them, you know. So I spent 3 days in jail. Have 3 years of probation. And, man, those 3 days were just horrible. Even though there's food and a place to stay, it's still, like, not a good environment, really. You know, I slept for 2 days and basically had a headache all the time. And the third day was, like, court. Woke up at midnight so that I can start the process of getting out. From like 12:30 to 6:30, I was inside the last holding cell where they give you your clothes, but yet you don't get your items that, you know, they took from you. They wound up throwing away her toothbrush and toothpaste. I don't know why they did that. And day after, all our stuff got taken. I don't have my wallet no more, or my bag or anything. Took blankets and the blue bag that you had given us and all the clothes that was inside of it. My wallet and everything else. But I'm going to try to get them back somehow.
And you think the police did this?
Either the police, Caltrans, or the park people. Not the prisoners, but the park maintenance people, I guess.
Well, I did notice earlier that the plant was cut down. You said you saw a sign there?
Yeah, it said, "Please remove property before disposed of." So, they were kind enough to let us take our stuff out, give us a chance to do it before they threw it away. So that was pretty cool. But I guess they cut that down while I was in jail, so... The day I got out, I had to go down there and take everything to the storage. So I stuck it all in there.
That's cool. And, like, what do you guys have left now that there was stuff taken?
A bunch of dirty clothes. And... borrowing some blankets, and we have 2 blankets of our own. And that's like about it, and the clothes we're wearing, basically.
Yeah, so, tell me the place that you got caught shoplifting from.
The Wally's IGA right across the street. Not allowed to go there no more. Can't go anywhere around the premises. well, except for Jack in the Box, I bet. I doubt I can go to the factory to you. Too close. And I guess there's also one in National City I'm not supposed to go to. It says that on my court papers, I guess. I pleaded guilty to get out of jail and just agreed to 3 years probation. Was supposed to get a fine of $400 to $1,000, but they dropped that, so I was lucky on that part. And my bail was posted at, or was made at, or blah, blah, blah. The bail was $15,500. And I guess at one point that told Ann that unless that was posted, that I wouldn't be able to get out. But I guess all that changed. But they tried to charge me with the felony, but busted it down to a misdemeanor. So it was like 2 counts of burglary and 1 of commercial burglary, so.
Well, tell me what you took from there. Do you remember the items?
2 steaks that totaled $8.03. It wasn't even $10 worth of food. I don't see why it was worth 3 days in jail and 3 years of probation.
Were you in a solitary cell or were you in...
No, it was open bunk.
Anybody you mess with you in there?
No. The only trouble I had is when we were coming back from court, too many people were talking, so they cross-chained you. And that's where they put your arms, like, across from each other. And that's very painful. But then some guy next to me leaned over and asked me, what is this called? And so I told him, so the cop ran up behind us and just, like, slammed us against the wall and then threw us against another wall, and we wound up riding in the cage of the big old sheriff bus. But I did not like that guy was fucking getting me in trouble like that. I was trying to fucking be good so I can come back, and even though this isn't much of a home, it's better than jail, shit.
Now, last time I talked to you, you'd mentioned you were staying in a friend's backyard?
Yeah, we don't stay there no more. We actually go back to the park even though we're not supposed to.
Same spot, or?
No, we went to an older spot that we had before where we never got caught. But when they tore out the tree stumps that were there, they wound up basically taking our stuff that was there, so we didn't go back for a while. But now we decided, you know, hey, what the hell, let's just go back. You know, until we get in trouble. We just stay where we have to stay, I guess.
Stuff behind. Just like the bottom, the lower estuary, there was a major fire here. Except for this fire was bigger. This fire was more dangerous. Look at how it charred the trees. And the ground was charred.
I'm surprised this whole place didn't go up in flames. Somebody is burning these animals' homes. And it always seems to be centered right around the homeless population. As you see, the fire spread pretty far and even charred some of the big trees. And all this, just inches from reeds where animals live. Look at this. A tire that would have burned for ages was lightly charred. Makes me wonder what else I'm gonna find out here. I guess somebody did. How they get up there, I don't know. If anybody still goes up there. That's obviously not for kids. Fresh litter. More charred stuff. Never good. It's never good to find burnt wood out in the middle of a wooded area. This looks like the old camp that they were talking about. Natural ice beer. Children's apparel. Family type stuff. A lot of 99 cent only store stuff. So I guess this is what they do when they move from camp to camp. They just abandon their stuff and leave it behind. Unknowingly creating a really, really bad litter problem here. I don't think I'm gonna bother. Some people don't like to be disturbed, especially when it means their homestead could be threatened. Tell me basically what happened with Marsha, like from the time
we had. That morning, she went to the food bank. She came back with deviled eggs. Me and Chiefy, we had deviled eggs and lettuce wrapped around the bear and everything. And then, Lori and Bobby came up, and we're all sitting there. I think she went and got a bottle of vodka, or maybe she was offered some, but she didn't feel good. And Bobby walked her over to a couch in the alley, put her to sleep. That's what she usually did. And then I was at the park reading a book, and I came back down the alley. I checked to see and she was dead, because I looked and twisted her head. She was purple. Checked her pulse. Well, the first time you talked to us was me and Marsha. Me and Marsha got pretty close, even though me and Marsha were friends. I didn't like it. She was there on the streets and everything. She should not have been on the streets. And now she's dead. Can't do nothing about that. And that, that put tears to me, I didn't know what to do. And Jeff and Annie found her. And they took it off me right there, so I didn't have to talk to anybody. I'm going to go by. They took cameras out there and stuff. Like they get checked and people come out and they rip those things off and have like a Pfizer fire hazard same jar or something, you know.
And when the police or the ambulance or whatever, when they came to get her, were you around? Did you see what happened?
No. I went by a little later and just had, you know, it's taped off, you know, in the area. And the cops are out there joking about something. I think she was still there because there was a bag there, so they hadn't taken her yet. And I just kept going. I stopped and see. You know, it didn't really matter at that point, you know, what happened. So it's, yeah, she's dead, you know.
Do you think the police knew who she was, like her name,
oh,
or?
They knew who she is. They knew her very well, but they arrested her enough times.
So do you think they maybe notified her children? Because she did mention she had some kids.
That's the point. We don't know. Because the people that know who her kids are and all, well, the police could probably come up with it. I'm figuring that they, you know, used their computers and stuff. Otherwise, there's a couple of people that would know, like Earl. And Lori right there. They would know. But she's been wanting to go see them for such a long time, and she hasn't been able to do it.
Did she have contact with them, do you know, or no?
No. I don't believe she did at all, because she wanted to find out where they're at, and I think it was found out where they're at, and so, but she never contacted them. So she has kids, and I think it's up in, God, I can't think of the name of the town. Lori knows. Up north, not too far. It's not Monterey, but Moray or something like that. Or
here in California?
Yeah, it's right up close here. When Marcia first came to this town, she was asking the whereabouts of a halfway house and stuff. Kind of. And we were talking, I didn't know where it was at, and I told her, well, you gotta go talk to somebody else and else, and I left. Left Earl with her. Anyway, and she never ended up going to the halfway house. She ended up going with Earl. Don't want to say nothing bad against Earl, because he was taking care of her too. Maybe she would never have made it to the halfway house anyway. But she should have went there. That was good.
Do you know how old Marcia was?
2 months younger than me. I would put her on March 18th. I'll be 50 years old. She's 2 months younger than me, so she'd be...
She would have just turned 50?
Yeah. 2 months from now, she'd be 50.
She would have just turned 50.
She had a hard life. She was your typical, I think, middle class wife and stuff like that at one time. When she first got here, she was dressed up nice and everything. She was real perky. And then from there, she just turned around. But she left someplace to be coming down here, too. She was in some kind of a home care or something like that to get here. You know, she'd be your perfect, when I first met her, she was just, you know, looked like a good mother and everything else. Can't tell. It's real hard to tell. She was very nice. She'd go out of her way to do anything for anybody. And she'd also be messing herself up at the same time. And that's probably why everybody loved you so much, is because you cared for everybody else. And at the same time, that's what killed her. Because all of a sudden, she gave up and she just quit. That was it. When she died, it took a little bit out of all of us that know her, because we know her for a long time. Like day one when she got in this town.
Just a month ago, I put my arms around her and said it's going to be okay. And now, she's gone. So it affects me, too.
Yeah, me too. I mean, she scared me sometimes. She'd grab my leg and tell me, we can go back over here by the bank and get a place to sleep back there. That would scare me. But besides that, she was a very, she was a caring person for everybody else. Anybody homeless up here, if they needed something, she would come up for it. Somehow she'd bum it. She might prostitute out for it, but she'd come up with the money for them to help them out. And that's, if you didn't ever think about that, this is something that goes on in the homeless areas, prostitution. And that's a biggie. You go out and make a bunch of money for a girl. You're on the streets. You come back in 30 minutes and you got 25, 40 bucks in your pocket. I'm still trying to figure this out myself. But I think I got it down pretty good.
Well, I seen a guy actually pick up Marsha and drive away, and Ann wasn't too happy about it. And I didn't have the camera on at the time, but it was a white car, and I guessed they told me he had picked her up a lot.
Yeah. But then I heard a bad time, too, with her once. She had to get out of the car and stuff, because some nut or something like that. It's dangerous. I mean, you're on the streets, and you do this, you put your life up when you start prostituting out, because you don't have the people or whatever. But you need the money, so you take the risk. Because you don't know what's going to happen. You live on the streets day to day, and the only thing is you got to watch your own back. That's why you're homeless, got everybody else watching your back. It's a very tight system. Like right now, we know you. We'd be watching your back. I'm not homeless, but they'd be watching your back.
If you could say one last thing to Marsha, what would it be?
Say I love her.
Hooray for a child that makes it through, if there's any way, because the answer lies in you. They're laid to rest before, they've known just what to do. Their souls are lost because they could never find what's this life. What's this life for?
love.